You're watching CarTell TV and I'm Simone. Now make sure you subscribe for more of the latest car reviews.
The Subaru Forester has been one of the most revered SUVs of its kind for a long time. There's never been anything too flashy about its design or features.
It was value for money, the perfect combination of spaciousness, dimensions, and outright capability. As it evolved, it lost some of its off-road dedicated perks, but even without them, its symmetrical all-wheel drive proved to be more than enough for most people. It really is an amazing system. But times have moved on and the Forester needed to modernize. No, not in terms of design. I mean, check it out. There are no design benchmarks here, just the mere definition of conservative.
No, by modernize, I'm talking about its powertrain. This version of the Forester now has an electric motor to help that boxer engine.
The one I have here is the Hybrid S. So it's the top version of the Forester currently available, and at this price range, it has some tough competition.
Most notably in the form of the Rav4 Hybrid.
Can this new Forester justify the price? Okay, well, I'm going to have to tell you the price before we move on.
Well, the entry-level Forester with a 2.5-litre petrol engine only starts from under $40,000 driveaway. The very top version with a hybrid powertrain gets a significant price bump to $51,000 driveaway.
Yes, it's actually a bit more expensive than the Rav4.
So on the design front, it doesn't really justify the price. While it doesn't look outdated, it also doesn't look particularly modern. They went for bulky shapes which perfectly complement the ruggedness that the Forester has boasted in this class.
Toyota used to be similar, but a few years back they drastically modernised their designs. Nevertheless, I'm sure there are Subaru enthusiasts out there who will actually love the fact that the new Forester is still a Forester at first sight.
Under the bonnet of this car, there's a combination of an internal combustion boxer petrol engine and an electric motor. Unlike the engine in the non-hybrid version, this one isn't a 2.5-litre unit, but a 2-litre four-pot.
This engine alone is also not as powerful as the 2.5-litre non-hybrid.
While that one has 136 kilowatts and 239 newton metres, the 2-litre one from the hybrid has 110 kilowatts and 196 newton metres. Of course, it gets a bit of extra boost from the electric motor to help it. And I mean, a bit. It's 12.3 kilowatts and 66 newton metres.
Now that's only a little difference, and when I get behind the wheel, I'll tell you why that shouldn't put you off. In the meantime, let me tell you the official fuel consumption figures.
The 2.5 litre in the non-hybrid version officially uses 7.4 litres per 100 kilometres in the combined cycle, while this hybrid version is at 6.7 litres.
Now that may not sound like much of a difference, but it is more noticeable in the city, where the hybrid Forester really benefits from the electric motor. We'll get to that in a minute.
Lastly, this fuel figure will greatly depend on where and how you drive, that is, how efficiently you're using the electric motor. We all know that official fuel consumption figures are usually quite optimistic, but from our experience over this week, the hybrid Forester can be driven at just a bit over 7 litres per 100 kilometres in real-world conditions, if you're reasonably careful. So that's a bit of nice, refreshing honesty from a manufacturer regarding fuel consumption.
Now, let's get behind the wheel.
Okay, first, let me quote to you how Subaru describes their hybrid powertrain.
Subaru e-boxer is a hybrid system which uses electric power from a compact battery and electric motor to assist the petrol engine in delivering better low-speed acceleration and torque for a more responsive drive. The e-boxer changes driving modes between engine only, electric vehicle only, and motor assist driving to best match the conditions and driver input.
You know what this is? More honesty. There's no talk of paradigm shifting or exhilarating performance, as there simply isn't anything like that.
What is there is a noticeable response from the electric motor when you're setting off or when you suddenly push the pedal to the metal.
The push is almost instant, and even though it doesn't throw you back in your seat, the reduction in lag time between your input and the push is very welcome.
The reason for this is something we've mentioned many times on our channel, and is that electric motors have all the torque from zero revs.
That's why performance electric cars accelerate the way they do.
Where an engine will have a hole in performance before it reaches its optimal revs, an electric motor will give all the push, and with an added 66 newton metres so low in the range, the help is more than noticeable when it comes to helping responsiveness.
Of course, this combination of powering options also gives room for different driving modes and also making the most out of each powering option.
For example, when you're out on the motorway, there's little to no regenerative braking and the electric motor would use up most of the stored power very quickly.
On the other hand, this is where internal combustion engines are most fuel efficient. This is why, in these conditions, your car will be propelled by the engine alone, which will also power the generator, which will keep the battery charged and ready to use.
The electric motor jumps in to help the engine during harder accelerations or pulling or climbing hills.
This is where you'll notice the power delivery. While not huge, it's efficient, very intuitive, and almost instant.
This kind of a response makes the Forester Hybrid feel more powerful than it really is.
But you can also drive the Forester in EV mode only. Still, this isn't a plug-in hybrid. You don't have a huge, heavy battery that will give you any kind of proper EV range.
Instead, the smaller, lighter, and more affordable battery serves to provide power for pulling away or driving at very slow speeds, such as under 20 kilometres per hour in heavy city traffic.
Of course, these are the conditions, like I'm in now, where the engine would be least fuel efficient. So aside from a reduced response time, this is where the electric motor really helps with that average fuel consumption figure.
Still, the moment you need any real power to increase the speed swiftly, the car will prevent the small battery from draining by immediately employing the engine to provide the push.
Of course, any deceleration or braking will charge the battery, which will further make city driving even more efficient, especially if you refrain from hard acceleration.
All this praise being sung, I have to say that the Forester with this setup is really not a powerhouse in any sense of the way. While the response is very nice, the power is sometimes lacking.
Accelerating up a steep hill is not very fun, and neither is quickly overtaking longer vehicles. And when you press the pedal, all of the power is delivered very, very quickly, but there's just not that much power to deliver.
There's one thing that is really smart for a vehicle like this, but I just don't like it. It has a CVT.
However, I can tolerate some of them, this one included. It's efficient, it's reasonably unobtrusive, and it does its job as it should.
Suspension is geared toward comfort rather than performance, which is a good idea, considering there isn't actually much performance behind this powertrain.
All in all, the one thing that Subaru is missing is definitely giving more from the electric motor and battery. It lags behind the RAV4 in this area, and while the motor really does make a difference to the engine, it makes the difference for a small, relatively underpowered engine. Like, it helps, but it doesn't make it awesome. And the engine here is far more active than in the RAV4, and that kind of defeats the purpose of a hybrid.
On the inside, the design is actually more modern than one would expect from designers at Subaru.
I was expecting excellent build quality, and I have to say, Subaru has delivered.
The fit and finish are excellent, and additions such as this exposed stitching really make the interior feel special.
A great bonus is found in material quality.
There are a lot of soft touch surfaces, especially those that you often touch, including this part at the top of the front doors, right under the window.
Older and shorter people climbing into the Forester can help themselves up by holding their hand here, and Subaru's made this a really nice surface. It's a small touch, but it really improves the feel of the car.
You can also find soft touch materials on the dashboard and even at the sides of the central console where your leg would rest.
The seats are awesome as well. They're very comfortable and supportive. They're bathed in leather and power adjusted. What most people will be thrilled about is there are actually three screens on the inside.
The 8-inch infotainment LCD touchscreen comes with sat-nav, Apple CarPlay and Android Auto, and a Harman Kardon sound system in this trim, voice commands, DAB plus radio, and all such things you would expect in a modern car. The small screen above it shows car features, temperature, climate controls, and similar. Lastly, there's this small screen in the instrument cluster.
When I saw that there were three screens, I thought perhaps this might be a bit confusing to know what's where, and it was for about 10 minutes. But actually, the layout and the features selection is pretty intuitive.
There are enough storage spaces, cup and bottle holders, tray in front of the gearbox lever, bin under the central armrest, and a glove box.
There are also two USB chargers up front, but even this top spec model doesn't have wireless charging.
In the back, there's lots of legroom and headroom for this class, even with this beautiful panoramic sunroof eating into the headroom.
Two adults in the back will have almost as much comfort as those in the front.
The rear also gets air vents and two charging points, as well as cup holders.
One thing I noticed is that the materials on the rear doors aren't as good as they are on the front. Not a major complaint, but I was so impressed with the materials on the front doors that my expectations were higher for the back.
The tailgate is electrically operated, which is nice, and opens at a nice pace. The boot has 508 litres of space and it has a nice shape.
It's a bit high, but there's no load lip. There's a bit of extra storage space, and the opening is among the widest I've seen.
The rear seats can be folded electrically for even more space.
What's not found in all this space is a spare wheel. Now, I know that's pretty common these days, but in a vehicle that's known for going off-road, this may be a deal breaker for some buyers.
The Forester comes with 5-star ANCAP safety rating, backed up by that lovely all-wheel drive system, electronic stability control, ABS, EBD, brake assist, traction control, active torque vectoring system, auto vehicle hold, electronic parking brake, pedestrian alert system, driver monitoring system with drowsiness and distraction warnings and facial recognition, rear view camera, adaptive driving beam, blind spot monitoring, eyesight assist monitor, lane change assist, adaptive cruise control, emergency lane keep assist, lane departure warning, lane sway warning, pre-collision braking and throttle management, rear cross traffic alert, reverse automatic braking, and front and side view mirrors.
Giving the final verdict for this car is really not an easy job. While it's a nice car with a nice interior, efficient powertrain, and a respectable history, it's a bag of mixed feelings.
Looking at it as a hybrid and as a city car, the Forester is easily left behind by the benchmark offering that is the RAV4.
When I look at it as a somewhat off-road SUV,
the revered symmetrical all-wheel drive is just awesome, but then the car is let down by the powertrain and equipment that are obviously geared towards city use.
While it's a good vehicle and will definitely be appreciated by Subaru fans, myself included, I have to admit that it will need a bit of refinement in order to justify its claim to the throne in this segment. Thanks for watching Cartel TV. Make sure you subscribe to our channel and follow us on social media. We'd love to hear from you. Now, the Subaru Forester Hybrid. Have they done enough to compete with the RAV4? And if you're looking for a Forester, would you pick the hybrid or choose the 2.5 litre? Let us know in the comments below.